अस्सलाम वालेकुम वरहमतुल्लाहि वबरकातुहू।
वालेकुम अस्सलाम वरहमतुल्लाहि वबरकातुहू।
प्रेजेंटली आई एम अ होम मेकर एंड आई एम अ साइंस ग्रेजुएट। माय क्वेश्चन टू यू इज इन रिगार्ड्स टू अ हीनियस कमिटेड क्राइम इन ऑफ अ 20 इयर्स ओल्ड गर्ल इन दिल्ली हु वाज रेप्ड इन अ मूविंग बस एंड दिस इशू इज इन हेडलाइंस इन अ रिकरिंग एंड प्रिंट मीडिया। सो माय क्वेश्चन टू यू इज दैट डज इस्लाम डिमांड अ गर्ल और अ वुमन to get 4 eyewitnesses that to prove that she has been raped, and what is the punishment in Islam for the rapist?
Sister has asked a very important question, and in fact because of the recent incident happening I was mentally prepared that there will be a question on this Sunday afternoon for this. Sister has asked a question that we recently came across a very heinous crime committed against a 23-year-old software engineer who was raped in Delhi, the capital of India, now being unfortunately referred as the rape capital of India also, not just the geographical capital of India but also the rape capital of India. And the story runs that 7 human dogs, I would call them 7 human dogs, they raped a 23-year-old girl, and she is in a critical condition, or rather she is recovering from that critical condition of her health. She is fighting back and trying to get the perpetrators, the criminals, to be booked and to be punished by the law of the land. So the sister,
being a woman,
I am very sure any woman would be very disturbed and hurt by this kind of a crime committed against any woman on the face of the earth, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, irrespective, any woman is a woman, they are human beings and they are sisters, and to us being the daughters of Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salam. So the sister has asked a question that as far as Islamic teachings go, what does Islam demand? Does Islam say that if a woman has been raped, then the woman who has been raped or the girl who has been raped shall bring 4 eyewitnesses to prove that she has been raped? And what is the punishment for the rapist in Islam? Thank you very much for a very important question you have asked. In fact, there is a lot of misunderstanding amongst the non-Muslims and a lot of Muslims also. They misinterpret and misunderstand one of the beautiful ayat of the glorious Quran. When you read Surah Nur, Surah number 24, ayat number 1 to ayat number 8, when you read these 8 ayat of Surah Nur, Surah number 24, you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in detail has discussed about the man and the woman committing fornication, or about a man and a woman committing adultery, and what is the procedure of establishing the crime of committing fornication or adultery. Let me repeat the statement again. What is the punishment in Islam of committing the crime of fornication and adultery? Mind me, Islam does not consider fornication and adultery as legal, which is considered in most of the countries of the world today, except Saudi Arabia, where if a man or a woman, if they are unmarried, if they are not married as legal husband and wife, and with their each other's consent they come together and have sexual intercourse, these countries do not call it a crime. Islam calls it a crime, a serious sin. Of the 7 major most sins in Islam, committing zina is one of them. And in such a case, when you read these ayat, Surah Nur, Surah number 24, ayat number 1 to 8, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discusses in detail about the fornicators and the fornicatress and the adulterer and the adulteress. Now what is the punishment, or what is the discussion Allah does about these people? What is the difference between fornicator and adulterer? Fornicator is the man who is a bachelor, who is unmarried, and he commits zina. He is called a fornicator in English. In Arabic, it's a common term, zani, meaning one who commits zina. Fornicator is referred to a man or a bachelor who is unmarried and commits zina. And adulterer is referred to a man who is married and commits zina with another woman who is not his wife. Then fornicatress is referred to a girl or a spinster who is unmarried and she commits zina. And adulteress is referred to a woman who is married and who commits zina with another man, or has sexual intercourse with a man who is not her husband. The punishment for these two category of people is different according to the Quran. What the Quran says is, if any bachelor, if any man who is not married has committed zina, if the person, if the man has committed zina, if the bachelor has committed zina with a married woman or unmarried woman, with whom he has committed zina is the second consideration in Islam. The first, if the man is unmarried, then the punishment to this boy or this man or this bachelor in Islam according to Quran, Surah Nur, Surah number 24, ayat number 1 to ayat number 8 is 100 stripes, meaning 100 kola, whips, whipping him 100 times in public. And Allah says, do not have mercy on that fellow. When you are doing that, absolutely do not have mercy on that person. What is the punishment for the spinster and unmarried girl doing this? The same punishment. In public, 100 whippings, 100 stripes on her, and do not have mercy upon her. In public, what is the procedure? Generally in the Islamic countries like Saudi Arabia, on Friday, there is a public holiday. It's not like Sunday. Saudi Arabia and the Arab countries have their public holiday on Friday. After Juma Salah, the people walk out of the masjid, and the masjid holding the largest number of people there. It has a huge ground in front of it. In that ground, there is a place which is totally separated to punish these people. The people coming out of the masjid, they gather around it, the common people gather around it, and the punishment is meted out to any criminal who has committed an Islamic offense, wherein he requires a public punishment, including a fornicator or a fornicatress. This is one of the punishment given according to the Quran to the fornicator and fornicatress. Coming to the adulterer, suppose the man is a married man and the girl is an unmarried girl. The punishment to the man will be different, to the girl will be different. If suppose the man is a bachelor and the girl or the woman is a married woman, then the punishment to the woman is different, to the man is different. The bachelor or the spinster, the unmarried boy or the unmarried girl, they will get the punishment of 100 stripes, and the married man and the married woman will be punished with rajam. What is rajam? Rajam is a procedure which invites the criminal or the adulterer or the adulteress to be half buried naked in the ground. They are buried half naked in the ground, and this is for the man. For the woman, she is half buried in the ground. And then the people coming out of the mosques, they are provided by the Islamic government stones in their hands. And these stones, they have to hit this criminal and finish this criminal. It's a serious crime in Islam. Islam considers cheating your wife or cheating your husband as a serious crime, which is punishable by death in Islam. So this punishment is meted out to the adulterer and the adulteress. At the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a sahabi and a sahabiya, they committed adultery. Both of them were married, but they committed adultery. And after understanding the importance of akhirah
and the day of judgment, they themselves went to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
The man went and he said, sahabi said, ya Rasulullah, I have committed adultery. I am a married man, still I have committed adultery. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam enjoined the Islamic punishment of rajam, which is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari volume number 8. When you read it, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says in one of the hadith, he says that I find some people thinking that the punishment of rajam has been abrogated, has been stopped. Verily, the Prophet never stopped this punishment, and it has to be continued. And this is how the punishment still continues of rajam even today. So this adulterer is put to death by stoning, or the adulteress is put to death by stoning. And the sahabi, he came to Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, ya Rasulullah, I have committed adultery. And he was punished by rajam. Then later, after he was put to death, the sahabiya, she came. She said, ya Rasulullah, I am the woman with whom he committed adultery. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, come to me after 3 months. The woman came after 3 months. The Prophet inquired, are you pregnant? She said, yes, I am pregnant, ya Rasulullah. The Prophet said, come to me after you deliver the baby. She came back again after delivering the baby. And the Prophet said, come to me after 2 years of breastfeeding the baby. She comes back again after 2 years, and now the Prophet ﷺ ordered rajam for her. When the Sahaba gathered and they were hitting with the stones, Khalid bin Walid, when his stone hit the woman, suddenly the blood stains of the woman, the blood flew out of the body, it rushed out of the body, and a few blood drops, they fell on the clothes of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he tries to wipe out the blood and he says, the blood of a very dirty, filthy woman has fallen on my clothes. Listening to this, our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he replied and he said, O Khalid, if the forgiveness the woman has sought in public, the way this woman sought the forgiveness in the public is so pleasing to Allah, that if one drop of the blood that came out of her body now, if I distribute it to entire Sahaba in Medina, all your sins will be forgiven for you. Reason? She feared Akhirah so much, she said, I don't want a punishment in the Akhirah. Whatever my punishment is, let me get it done today. And you see Allah's planning now, because she was afraid of Allah, she did it for the love of Allah. Today you and me, instead of abusing her, are respecting her now. And it's a big time. Her mind didn't change. Her fearing for Allah didn't change. She was pregnant. She was asked to come 3 months later. She comes 3 months later fearing Allah again. 9 months pass. She comes again. She has a baby. Now she has an affection to the baby now. She again comes back. She says, no problem. Allah is Rabbul Alameen. If I am the mother, Allah is the one who created my baby. I just gave birth to the baby, but the creator is Allah. She comes back again. She says, Ya Rasulullah, punish me. The Prophet says, 2 years later, imagine a mother having the affection with the baby for 2 years. She's breastfeeding the baby. 2 years back again she comes. 2 years later. Why? Fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Prophet gave the punishment. This is the Islamic punishment meted out to the man or the woman who are married and commit zina in Islam. Now the question is, how should they be caught? How are you going to say that this man committed adultery or this woman committed adultery? So Quran lays down a principle again. And this is the only religious book on the face of the earth which even to the last extent defends the esteem, the self-respect of even a fornicator and an adulterer, or a fornicatress or an adulteress. What does Quran say? If anyone is laying down a claim of fornication or adultery on any person, then the one who is laying down the claim shall come with 3 more witnesses, making 4 witnesses altogether. What witnesses? Eyewitnesses. 4 eyewitnesses shall be brought in order to say that this man or this woman have committed fornication or adultery. To say that this person has committed zina, this man or this woman have committed zina, the person who claims, the Quran says, shall come with 4 eyewitnesses. And Allah says, if they are 3 eyewitnesses, 3 people saw doing this act, 3 people saw a man and a woman doing zina, 3 people come and they say, Wallah, by Allah, we keep Quran on our head, we saw, 3 people are saying this. You know what does the Quran say? 80 stripes to each one of them, they are liars. In their lifetime, do not take any witness from them again. Allah is defending even a zani in Islam. 3 people, they saw, they are saying, Wallah, the 4th is not present there, the 4th witness is not there. Allah says to each one of them, 80 stripes, you can't open your mouth. You must have seen it, it must be perfect. 3 people saw, the 4th is missing. Quran says, 80 stripes to each one of them, and from this date onwards, do not take their witness till their life ends. They are liars in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Based on this teaching of the Quran, believe me, since the time this ayat was revealed till this date, not a single punishment has been meted out in the world to any Muslim man or woman on the basis of eyewitnesses. Reason? Why would any man or woman commit zina in front of 4 eyewitnesses? Meaning Allah, even for such a severe sin, is giving an opportunity to the man and woman to seek Allah's tawbah, to seek Allah's forgiveness. Allah is saying, they are my servants, they must have committed the sin. If they return to me for forgiveness, I am ready to forgive them. You see, what does Allah say in Surah Zumar, Surah number 39, ayat number 53? Say to my servants, you know what, the ayat is so beautiful. You see, our parents sometimes say, Mera bacha, my son, this is my baby. My baby, my baba, mera beta, meri beti. Allah is calling us. Ya ibadi, Say to them, O my servants, do not despair of the mercy of Allah. La takhnatu min rahmatillah. Do not think that Allah is not merciful to you. Seek sincere forgiveness with Allah, for verily you will find Allah most merciful and forgiving you. So Allah says, seek forgiveness from me. Now coming to this, four eyewitnesses, for whom? For zina. Zina means when a man or a woman have committed sexual intercourse outside the house of marriage, without being married to each other legally, without being husband and wife unto each other, if they commit zina, and if you have four eyewitnesses to it, then the punishment is meted out. Or in the case of Sahabi and Sahabiya, they themselves came to say, we did it. There were no eyewitnesses. They came forward to say. Then in Islam, you see what happened in that incident? The Sahabi said, I did it. The judge in Islam cannot ask, with whom did you do it? Otherwise, he will be punished. Even if a man comes out to say, I committed zina, the judge does not have an authority to ask with whom. If he asks with whom, and this fellow says the name of some girl, she says, I committed with some girl, some A, B, C, some girl, he takes the name. The girl is approached. The girl denies now. She says, I didn't do it. You know what happens? If this man is a married man, before Rajam, he will be given 80 stripes punishment, 100 stripes punishment first, and then he will be killed. Why? 100 stripes? Because he took the name of the girl without four eyewitnesses. And Rajam, because he committed, I have done it. If the girl comes and says, I did it with this person, without four eyewitnesses, and the man denies, I didn't do it, there is no other inquiry. The girl will be given 100 stripes, and then Rajam if she is a woman who is married. So Islamically, you can say, I did the sin. But Islam defends, even in that stage, Islam defends the other person. The izzat of Muslim is so important in the sight of Allah. The izzat of a human being is so important in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the case, he can go and he says, I did it. No four eyewitnesses, he can talk about only himself. This is the only way Islam meets out the punishment to a zani or a zaniya. Meaning either they should come out themselves, or they should bring, other people should bring four eyewitnesses. If this is not there, between Allah and those people now. They seek forgiveness, Allah forgives. If Allah wants to punish, it is His decision on the Day of Judgment. Maliki Yawmiddin. Nobody can prevent Him. He is the master of the Day of Judgment. As Allah Himself says in Surah Fatiha, Surah number 1, Maliki Yawmiddin. He is the master of the Day of Judgment. Now coming to rape. Why did I speak all this? I was actually trying to clarify the misconception held by a lot of non-Muslims and by certain Muslims also, ignorant Muslims, who think for zina bil jabr. Zina bil jabr is the Arabic connotation used for rape. R-A-P-E, rape. Rape is referred in Arabic as zina bil jabr. Jabr means to force. Zina means fornication, illegal sexual activity forced upon somebody else. What is the punishment in such a case if the girl goes out and says to the authority that I have been raped? Based upon any standard of inquiry, whatever you have, DNA test or any other test, no four eyewitnesses for it. The Quran never says for zina bil jabr produce four eyewitnesses. Absolutely not there. For zina bil jabr, whatever is the standard of time, based on that standard of time, an inquiry will be done. And if the standard of time proves that this woman has been raped by this rapist, based on DNA verification or any other procedure, then Islam talks to the authorities. There is no direct ayat in the Quran which says, do this to the criminal, do this to the rapist. Because sister added a question saying, what does Islam say about the punishment for the rapist? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Quran in Surah Maida, Surah number 5, ayat number 33, has given the authority or the Muslim Khalifa, the Muslim ruler or the Muslim government, the permission to either kill the person, to either exile him, that is life imprisonment as we have in certain countries, or to cut off his limbs in opposite direction. Right hand and the left leg will be cut off, or the left hand and the right leg will be cut off. It will be removed from his body as a punishment. Or if the authority wants, they can use any other method of punishment. Reason, Allah says in Surah Maida, Surah number 5, ayat number 33,
whoever strives on the land to disobey Allah and His Messenger,
either kill him, exile him, put him on the cross, or cut off his limbs in opposite directions. Based on this ayat, many Muslims do not know that even if a person is eve-teasing, you understand what is eve-teasing? Bachchi ko chhedte na road par, eve-teasing. You eve-tease and the girl complains, the authority in Islam is authorized to kill you as a punishment. The Quran says if anybody does anything against Allah and His Messenger, the authority is authorized even to give capital punishment only for eve-teasing. Leave aside rape. Most of the countries in the world today, where you will find, in most of the countries, the laws of the rape are different because the definition is not fixed. I don't want to go in the detail of the different definitions for rape. I will just tell you what is the Islamic definition for rape. The Islamic definition for rape is when a man, he forcefully penetrates his private organ into the private organ of a woman without her consent. That's rape. If a woman, she forcefully has a sexual intercourse with any man, wherein the penetration of the private organ of the man is done in the woman's private organ, that is rape in Islam, and the punishment is meted out. This is the definition of rape. I don't want to go with 100 more definitions in other places that are followed. Based on this, rape is a serious crime in Islam. In the latest reports, as the sister said, that after the incident happened with the 23-year-old girl in Delhi, so many newspapers are talking so much about Indian law, American law, UK law, Sweden law, Australian law. I'm saying you people are so dishonest. You're not talking about Saudi Arabia. The crime of rape is so less in Saudi Arabia, it's the least affected country with the crime of rape, because every rapist in Saudi Arabia, he's well aware what will happen to him if he rapes. You know, there is a survey given in Times of India. It's not a very old survey, it's a recent survey. It's 19th December 2012. Today is 23 December 2012. 19th December 2012. On page number 11 of Times of India, there is a survey report which says, in America, they adopted the castration method. Castration mane, mard ko namard bana dena. Castration method in order to control rape crime. And the survey report says, if a rapist is punished in the jail, if he is sent to the jail, the chances of him again raping a girl is 97%. He will 97%, in 97% cases, he will come out to rape the girl again. By castration, it is only 3%. Namard bana diya to 3%. I say follow the Islamic rule followed in Saudi Arabia, it will be 0%. If that fellow doesn't live, where is the question of one more person or one more time he'll try it? Kill him! Islam gives the best solution to the rapist. Put him to death, finish him. You can't do such a dastardly act. You can't behave like this. It's a dirty devil's act. How can you do a rape? How can you be so criminal in your mentality? According to another report published on 20 December 2012 in Times of India, the report says that the top psychiatrists of Bangalore, of Mumbai, of Delhi, they say that the rapist is not a psychologically ill person. He's a criminal in his mentality. As a man, he tries to prove his manliness in a wrong way by proving his aggression. He is a criminal in his mind. He should not be brought for any treatment. There is nothing of his mental illness. He is a criminal. Punish him like a criminal. What is the report for India? According to another survey done in India, which is reported in another newspaper, which is dated as 24th November, it says that the National Crime Record Bureau for the year 2007, it said that two-thirds of the women raped in the year 2007 were between the age group of 18 to 30 years. That was their age group. They were raped in that age group. And the report says that 92.5% of the rapists were those men whom the girl knew. You see, when you don't make hijab, when you freely intermingle with anybody, what Islam says is, you may be a good girl, but you do not know the person you are meeting. His mind, he may behave to be good, but in his mind he may be a criminal. So 92.5% of the rapists were the men who were known to the girl. In the USA, the report says that 47% of the rapists at the time of rape, both man and woman, when they were raped, when the girl was raped, both of them, 47% of the times they were drunk. In 17% of the cases, the perpetrator, the rapist, was drunk. In 7% of the cases, the victim was drunk. Islam puts a ban on alcohol. You don't want to follow the practical laws Islam has given for humanity, you are suffering. Just on Friday, last Friday, that is on 21st of December 2012, there was an interview on the news channel by the news channel took an interview with the incumbent Delhi Police Commissioner, and I was surprised what has happened to the mentality of the women here in India. I don't know. There were 4 to 5 women. They were asking him a question, and he was saying that, you see, I tell my daughters, my young daughters, I have 2 daughters, they are young, I tell them that, beta, when you go out in any party or any other function, make sure that you don't return late in the night to the house, because the women are more vulnerable towards the crime of rape. Meaning, suppose there are 2 shops. One shop is a jewelry shop, and just beside that shop, there is a shop of selling newspapers and magazines. Which is more vulnerable to the theft? But naturally, the jewelry shop. So suppose the police person, they come and they say to the jewelry shop owner, sir, you please install CCTV cameras, make sure that you have a security bell for you. And this fellow, the jewelry shop owner, is telling to the police, sir, are you going to give the same advice to the shop beside me? You got my point? You are discriminating. I have a jewelry shop, you want CCTV cameras. Are you saying the same thing to him? He is a logical fellow. You are more vulnerable to that threat. The police commissioner is saying the girls are more vulnerable to this crime. A man getting raped by a girl is hardly heard of. Hardly we hear that a woman raped a man, except for Western countries like in US or UK. Hardly in India we ever heard that a woman raped a man. Woman is more vulnerable to the crime. He gives a beautiful advice, and a girl, because she is pre-programmed with the media and the ideology of the modern times, she is asking him, sir, this is unfair. You are discriminating. You said you tell to your daughters, return to home by 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. Do you give the same advice to your son? What kind of a girl are you? What kind of women have you become? Our DGP Dinesh Reddy, Director General of Police, I don't know how many of you know the protocol, he is the highest ranked police officer of any state. The Director General of Police of Andhra Pradesh, Dinesh Reddy, on 31st December 2011, he gave a very good advice saying dress code plays a major role. If you are improperly dressed, there are chances, high chances, that the criminals may attack you. Physically, they may assault you. Physically, they may rape you. 1st January 2012, the new year begins with the feminist movement shouting against the DGP. What wrong did he say? He said be properly dressed. They don't want to do it. You know, this is Times of India, 5 December 2011, Monday, page number 12. Dress code in court, jury out on Supreme Court order. Dress code in the court. You know what happened in the High Court? Czechoslovakian couple
was brought for prosecution for some crime. The judge imposed 2,000 rupees fine on each one of them, saying that they were improperly dressed in the courtroom.
The news article goes saying the Supreme Court directed that court is a place of serious business. You cannot be so liberal in this place. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Zariyat, Surah number 56, and in Surah Mulk, Surah number 67, ayat number 2, that this life is an examination for you, and you have been created with the serious business of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 24/7, you are in a serious business, you have to see you are worshipping Allah. Why only court? So Islam is saying at all times be properly dressed. According to National Crime Victimization Survey report for the United States of America for the year 2006, can you imagine, only from 2005 to 2006, 232,960 women were raped. 2,32,960 women raped only 1 year. That is equal to 600 women per day. Can you imagine that figure? According to India, India according to another report published in Deccan Chronicle for the year 2009, Monday page number 8, dated 24th November, it says that India happens to be the third highest rape recording country in the world after USA and South Africa. According to another report published on the 22nd of July, Deccan Chronicle page number 8, it says the rape crime in India from 1953 to 2011 increased by 873%. Can you imagine that? By 873%, the crime rate increased in India against the women. And according to another report published in the Deccan Chronicle, 13 February 2011, page number 9, the report says that out of 69 rape cases, only one is reported in India. Out of 69, only one is reported in India. And the report further says the chances of a college going girl being raped in India is 4 times higher than any other girl or a woman. It's the highest time, it's the highest risk for the girls going to the college. According to another report published in the newspaper, a survey was done in the Tihar jail. I don't know how many of you know Tihar jail. It is the toughest jail in India, in North India, where all the hardcore criminals are put there. Abu Salem and all these underworld dons, terrorists, they are put there. A survey was done in that jail and 242 convicts who were brought to the jail for raping the women, they were surveyed. How many? 242. 242 criminals in Tihar jail were put in Tihar jail because they raped women. A survey was done and they were asked, on an average, each one of them were caught only after committing the fourth rape. Meaning, for the first time they went free, second time they went free, third time they went free, fourth time they were caught only after 4 times. And after some time they will get the bail, they are out, they will again commit the crime. According to another report published in the newspaper, the report says that 70% of the rape victims, they were afraid that the rapist will come back again to commit the crime with them. Islamic solution is capital punishment. The girl who has been raped, 23-year-old girl, ask her what would she wish for the 7 who have raped her. Naturally, she will say, put them to death. That is what the first question she asked after coming to consciousness was, have they been arrested and are they going to be punished? That is the first thing she asked. So what does Islam say to a rapist? Capital punishment. That's the best that we can do to any rapist in the world. That's the worst thing that any man can ever do against any woman on the face of the earth. It's the worst thing to do. The BBC report, the report says, in the UK alone, in England, from 2010 March to 2011, 15,940 women were raped. Meaning on an average, divide that with 365 days, almost 230 women per day. I'm saying, or rather 43 women per day. Is it a small figure? In India, the statistics shows that on an average, every 22 minutes, one woman is raped in India. In America, every 1 minute, 2 women are raped on an average. So which is the safest place for the women on earth as of now? Saudi Arabia. Why? The law goes there. The law doesn't go only for the rapist. The law goes for the dress code of the woman also. Allah says in Surah Nur, Surah number 24, ayat number 30, say to the believing men to lower their gaze and guard their modesty so that their taqwa increases, their God piety increases in them. And say to the believing women, ayat number 31, to lower their gaze, guard their modesty, cover their bosoms, meaning do not walk on the streets showing your bosoms to the people. It can attract a criminal in a wrong way towards you. It will give an opportunity to a wolf on the road, to a dog on the road to bite you wrongly. Cover your bosoms, except those relations with whom you can never marry. Allah says in Surah Ahzab, Surah number 33, ayat number 59, Qul, say, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, the ayat begins, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, O you Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qul li azwajika, say to your wives, wa banatika, to your daughters, wa nisa'il mu'minina, and to the believing women, Yudnina alayhinna jalabi bihinna, say to them that they shall cover themselves from the head to the toe. Reason the Quran gives, so that they are not molested, so that they are not eve teased, so that Even a criminal, if he sees a woman walking on the road with a complete dress code or wearing a hijab, even he will try to respect, because that gives an impression that this girl is good. Some people, some smart people, they come up with arguments. You see, today there are so many girls who are wearing hijab and doing wrong things. You must have heard this argument. There are so many girls who are wearing hijab and still performing criminal actions. They are doing sinful things. So I tell them, take a ratio. There are many girls without wearing hijab who are doing greater sinful things. So are you going to tell them, remove your dress also now? This logic doesn't apply. If some girls, they are wearing hijab and doing something wrong, they are doing wrong. It has nothing to do with hijab. Hijab is not made to be worn by a woman so that she becomes pious. She is made to wear it more that she does not become a victim of another man on the opposite side. It's not because Allah doubts the chastity and modesty of the girl. It's because to protect her modesty and chastity. We do not have a Z-zone security around the VIPs. We do not have President Obama under such a big security cover because American population doubts Obama, who is the President of America. It's not because we doubt Prime Minister Manmohan Singh because of his security. It's because they shall be protected. They are important. Similarly, in Islam, women are very important. Whether a Muslim woman or a non-Muslim woman, both women are important. Allah said, protect them. Their modesty is important. Their chastity is important. You see, psychological, the experts, they stand by Islam. How? If a man is raped, makes no difference to him. If a girl is raped, psychologically, she is under a trauma. She is under a distress. She is in depression. There are chances that she will commit suicide. There are chances that she may be isolated in your community because she has been raped. She is more at a dangerous end or a receiving end than a man. Islam gave a condition. Let her wear a proper dress code. Told the man, lower down your gaze. In Saudi Arabia, even after the dress code is worn, somebody commits a crime, the severest punishment is meted out to him. Capital punishment for them. And you see, the control is there. But we Muslims, we need to educate the non-Muslims outside and our Muslim sisters also. When France banned hijab, we had protests in Hyderabad. I was saying, you people are only doing a drama to be known to the Muslims around you. See, you people are so worried about the hijab. So many Muslim girls are not wearing hijab in Hyderabad. First, bother about them. Forget, France is too far from you. There are so many Muslim girls in Hyderabad who don't wear it. But you never talk, you protest against them. You go on the road to educate these girls, your sisters at home. You know, in the recent times, there are all fests going on in colleges. You have so many Muslim colleges and non-Muslim colleges where Muslim students, you know, in the fest there are reports that Muslim girls were doing mujra. Astaghfirullah. Mujra is the new dances that are done. Who are doing the Muslim girls? The non-Muslim girls looking at them are amazed. Is this what Islam teaches these girls? They boast so much about hijab to the whole world and look at what they are doing now.
I don't want to take the names of those colleges. Popular Muslim colleges. Muslim colleges.
And some non-Muslim missionary colleges where our Muslim girls are going. Look at what they are doing. Look at their pictures on the internet, on the YouTube. You can see Muslim girls on the YouTube wearing complete hijab and smoking in the classroom. And they're very proud that they're being video recorded. They don't mind it. This was never our society. Go to the hookah bars in our city today. A majority of the children and the students there, Muslims. Muslim girls in the hookah bars. Where is our society rushing? These are things that invite different criminals to approach you in wrong ways. Islam is a balanced religion. Islam says, be decently dressed, and at the same time, if somebody still commits a crime, they should be punished severely. And also, if you read the Vedas, Rig Veda book number 8, hymn number 33, verse number 19, it clearly mentions that a non-Muslim woman, a Hindu woman, she shall pull her legs together. She shall look down and she shall cover herself completely. You see, in the Ramayana serial, whenever we saw Sita, she was completely dressed like a very decent woman. She was never shown dressing like a Western community girl in a bikini. She is always very nicely dressed, like a decent woman. You go to Rajasthan even today, are the Rajasthan Hindu women practicing Islam? They pull their cloth, their sari, over their faces. Did any Muslim go to them to say that you please cover your faces, wear the hijab? No. the natural shyness they have. They do it with it. You see the Hindi serials shown when a woman is married, in the next morning when she serves the morning tea to her in-laws, she is very decently dressed, totally covered from the head to the toe. You see the Durga Ma, who is worshipped by the Hindus as the goddess, she is always completely dressed from the head to the toe. Mother Teresa won a Nobel Prize, head to the toe, she is always covered. Mother Mary, you have so many statues, completely covered. There are so many nuns serving the God in the churches, completely covered. There are so many sannyasi women serving in the mandir, completely covered. Why only shout against Islam and Islam says the Muslim woman should also be covered? Where is Islam against any other religion? Where is Islam other than the normal course of life that any other religion wants you to follow? So based on this, Islam sister makes it very clear that for the rape victim, she did not produce any four witnesses. No four eyewitnesses for her. And the rapist, options are given in Surah Maida, Surah number 5, ayat number 33 for the authority. Capital punishment, exile, that is life imprisonment, never will he come out of the prison again. No bail for him. Once he is into the prison, forever in the prison. Third, cut off his limbs from the opposite directions. Fourth, crucify him. Best, if I am the authority, always the capital punishment to the rapist. No other option for him. I hope I answered the question, sister.